the Royal Hippodrome Theatre, Mr. James Paul McCartney, a musician from a more robust seaside resort in the northwest of the country, is getting a taste for Eastbourne rock. It's a rehearsal with his band Wings before they start their first British tour for 3 years. A tour which will start in Paul's hometown of Liverpool. The song has many Liverpool memories for Paul. He sang it first in 1956 at Walton Parish Hall in the south of the city, with a group who later became known as the Beatles. In Liverpool, it's not only the song that's been forgotten. The Beatles, too, seem a distant memory. The Cavern Club, where they played 292 times, has been demolished and turned into a car park. The club which took the Cavern's name now caters for new wave bands, and the punks who go there don't revere Paul or the memory of the Fab Four. Even the club's fiberglass icons of the Beatles have been ripped out and dumped nearby. According to Doreen, the club's secretary, they were bad for business anyway.
Well, we like to play down the image a lot. We have people knocking at the door day in, day out, especially American tourists, asking for the Beatles. We got a birthday card for John Lennon on his birthday.
Well, this year?
Yes. Oh, yes, October.
And what did you do with that?
Throw it in the bin.
The Beatles' first manager, Alan Williams, still lives in Liverpool. He's been trying for years to generate Beatles nostalgia without success.
The Beatles really and honestly mean nothing to the people of Liverpool anymore. Hence, I'm the chairman of the Beatles fundraising committee to build a statue. And our total money in from all over the world is about £230. In Liverpool, they just don't want to know the Beatles.
But the fans do want to know Wings. Without any publicity, their three Liverpool concerts are sold out within 2 days. In Eastbourne, Paul knows he must rehearse his band for weeks to make sure their live performance matches their records. There are two new musicians in the band, drummer Steve Holly and guitarist Lawrence Juber. Until now, the only contribution they've made has been in the recording studio, where any mistakes can be corrected. Now there's no second chance. Each song must be right first time.
I remember the first time, I wasn't in the group at the time of Mullican Tire, but I remember hearing that for the first time at Denny's house at Christmas, you know, or near Christmas now. I said, what on earth is this all about? You know? And there you've got like the biggest selling record ever in the UK, so I can't argue with it anymore. Yeah. You know?
But are you both of you, 10, 11 years younger than Paul and
yeah.
Do you feel you've joined a middle-aged band?
I have, yes.
Does it make any difference?
I think the only thing is that I've still got a lot of the enthusiasm that's obviously, you know, for a time would probably wane for a while, you know. I'm just talking about you.
Yeah, we're talking about how middle-aged
bands are. These young boys.
Do you think it is a middle-aged band, Wings?
Not now we've got these two, is it?
Take me home, Laura.
Do you ever in your own mind compare the two bands, the Beatles and Wings?
Yeah, sure.
I mean, how do you think the two do compare?
Well, we want to be as... Well, you see, they were together a long time as a band, and doing Hamburg and all that sort of thing. Gave them that sort of tight-knit thing, you know, which we haven't got yet. I mean, it's getting there, but I mean, it's going to take us a couple of years with this lineup before we get to that thing, you know. See, they don't know until we're on stage what the reaction's going to be. I know a little bit more because I've done it before with the band, but they still don't know, you know. Steve! They still haven't had all that yet.
You're starting the tour in Liverpool. Yes. I'm just wondering why you're going back to Liverpool first of all.
That's where the promoter made the first date. He said, "You're going to Liverpool." I said, "Oh yeah."
Nah, come on. Great. It's because you haven't done much in Liverpool and we love it.
I mean, is it
there's
a
theatre there they're trying to save. Have you heard about Ken Dodd was trying to, he did a pantomime there.
Yeah.
And it's one that would have to close down or something. We always said that when we next came back to Liverpool, we'd play that place. So that's the Royal Court Theatre. And I used to go there when I was a kid, you know, sit, watch all the plays up in the One and Sixpennies.
Extra police will be on duty in Liverpool tonight when former Beatle Paul McCartney takes the stage at the Royal Court Theatre. Paul and his band Wings are appearing in his native city to fulfil a promise he made to launch his new British tour on Merseyside.
It's just great, you know.
From Liverpool, that's it.
Yeah, me and my brother have been fans for ages, you know.
Bees are queued up 26 hours to come and watch.
Yeah. 26 hours?
Yeah. We got down there about 10 o'clock in the morning on Saturday and got our tickets about 12:15.
If McCartney wasn't in this band, you wouldn't see all these people here now.
Theatre staff are predicting the greatest explosion since the Merseybeat mania of the 60s, and the police are taking no chances. They're prepared to draft in extra men at the first signs of the hysteria McCartney attracted during the heyday of the Beatles.
For a time, it seemed as though Liverpool was the centre of the musical world. In 1962, there were said to be 400 groups playing in the city's clubs, pubs and dance halls. Competition for local popularity was intense. For a time, it seemed every other back-to-back house in Liverpool was a makeshift rehearsal room. It was from this musical ferment that the Beatles emerged after a formative period in Hamburg nightclubs with their first record, Love Me Do, in October 1962. 10 months later, their fourth record was out and they'd all left Liverpool behind for good. Paul McCartney's old school, the Liverpool Institute near the Anglican Cathedral. 3 years after leaving, Paul was internationally famous, overshadowing the school's previously most celebrated old boy, Arthur Askey. But today, the former member of the Quarrymen, as the Beatles were called in 1960, is going back to school, or rather, the school's paying him a nostalgic visit. His band Wings is giving a free concert for all 600 pupils in Liverpool's Royal Court Theatre. Hoping to meet him is his former geography teacher, Blip Parker.
Mr. Parker, what can you remember of Paul when he was at school, when he was in your geography class?
Well, I remember him as a very bright and cheerful lad who did a reasonable amount of work, a boy of his age.
Was he a studious academic type?
One could hardly call him that.
How many times have you seen him since he left the Liverpool Institute?
Just once, and that was very soon after he'd left.
This was before he was famous, was it?
Yes, before he was famous.
And what was that occasion, then?
He was repaying a small debt, actually, to my wife.
What was that?
A sixpence that he'd borrowed to go to the cinema.
Do you think that he will feel slightly embarrassed or nervous when he sees you?
I don't think so.
It is you, too. I wasn't sure if it was old Blip himself.
great. And this is a representation of the lads.
Yes, quite a few of them.
Still as lousy looking as they were when I was there. Used to sit in class, you know, and he'd just say, right, boys, dictation. And you just have to dictate all whole lesson. Just, it was like secretarial. Does he still do that?
Yeah.
A glacial explosion and the lateral moraines.
Paul failed art at A-level, and as if to make amends, the school's art teacher presents him with a gift.
And this is on behalf of the staff and the boys.
God, blimey, they freaked out since I went there.
That's painted by one of our sixth formers.
That's about Stan Reed. Go mad, wouldn't you? What's all this? Filthy language.
That's not directed at you. It's an illustration, actually.
We're broad-minded these days. Great. It's great, what is it?
There are about 1,500 Liverpool children, including those from Paul's old school, in the theatre for the free concert. Their response is on the enthusiastic side of idolatry.
I was alone to the right, I didn't know what I would find. Well, maybe I could see another kind of mine. Hey! Ooh, then I suddenly see you. Ooh, did I tell you I need you every single day of my life? What can I do? What can I be when I'm with you? I wanna stay. I'll never leave, and if I do, I know the way. Yeah. Ooh, I was meant to be near. Ooh, I don't want you to hear me say we'll be together every day. Got to get you into my life.
When you were starting out as a school kid and you decided not to have a job, there are thousands more kids in that position now because they don't even have the choice of getting a job.
It's the bureaucrats.
What do you feel about that? Because they haven't got the same escape route as you, have they?
Yes, they have. Everyone's got the same escape route, you know. Everyone, it never gets any worse that, you know, if you want to get out and do it. I mean, you know, to hear people talk, you'd think that, like, there was no one these days who was ever making any money and everyone was a flop these days and everyone was on the dole, but they're not, you know. If you go, like, 10 minutes out of any city, there's a row of very nice houses, thank you very much.
Well, I got to get you in my life.
A 100 yards from the Royal Court Theatre in a pub in the shopping precinct, four young musicians calling themselves Motion Pictures are trying to make it big just like the Beatles did 17 years ago. The singer is an electrician. The keyboard player works in a bank, the guitarist is a garage mechanic, and the drummer's on the dole.
We want to be good and we want to last as well as a band. We don't want to be a one-hit wonder.
Well, obviously, if you've got more money to spend and you're more famous, you've got to alter, haven't you?
Well, why have you got to? I mean, why can't you live the life that you're leading now? I mean, just watching the telly when you want to. I mean, you were going to go out shopping tonight. Why can't you do that? Late night shopping.
You can watch
like
the telly when you want to, but you can't go out shopping because you might get mobbed or something. A bit of luck.
Hopeful. Do you think you'd become more vain if you were famous?
I don't think I'd get much more vain than I am now.
But the worst thing is that, like, you start off as, like, nothing, like most people, you know, and you work your way up and you get success. And then you get there, and then all these people come around saying, you must be awfully embarrassed and cut off now that you've actually made it. It must be a real drag, you know. You've got to kind of sit around thinking, well, wait a minute, it's not that bad. I mean, I can have a moan like the next man, you know, about it. Yes, it's sometimes embarrassing and all that. But what's the alternative, you know? It's like...
Yeah, well, you could become a husband, couldn't you?
A husband?
I could become a husband, I'm working on that. I mean, I started, when I left school, I didn't want to get a job, so I joined a group. Well, like, now it's turned out to be quite a job. You know, it's like, it's not like it was.
I mean, has it become like a sort of factory
a
job?
A job. Yeah, it's become a lot more like a job than I ever intended it to be. But it does for
boring.
Everyone. Pardon?
That sounds boring if it's like a job.
It is. Very boring. It's like your job. No. You know, it can be very boring, sure. Yeah, you know, like any job. But you're either one of those people who can sit at home... Not to see. When I was at school, like everyone, I always thought, well, what I'll do is I'll get successful one way or another, get a lot of money, then I'll go on holiday for the rest of my life. You know, that'd be great. That, but if you ever see any of these people who really do that and who just go and get suntanned the rest of their lives, and they all crack up and go funny, you know,
that's not much fun.
It's not that good. That's a bit boring. That's even more boring. We're just really lucky to be even sane.
Paul's always made it a strict rule to keep his family out of the public glare. Tonight is to be a family celebration of the opening night of the Wings tour, but he's broken his usual rule to let us eavesdrop on the McCartneys in party mood. Many of Paul's relatives are already world famous in name because he insists on writing them into his songs. There's Brother Michael, Auntie Jin, Sister Susie, Cousin Ian. But there are no airs and graces, and none of the usual showbiz hypocrisy.
Family occasions like this, because it's a tight family do, isn't it? How tight is the family? How important?
They're going to be tight in a minute. After a couple more drinks, they're going to be really tight.
One of the feelings you get about a do like this is that it's just so, you know, an ordinary family do, and there's no sort of airs and graces or anything like that.
Well, is that how it feels
to you?
Yeah, so it's always been, you know. It's since I was a little kid, you know. It's the same thing, same do's. We're always like this.
I mean, why aren't they sort of in awe of you? I mean, because...
They don't like
you.
You're
a superstar, aren't you?
No. No, I'm not. Not tonight.
What about your kids? Because I know you're very sensitive about them not being in the public glare.
Well, yeah, you know, we try and keep them out of it. Because you see so many other kids, you know, who get in the kind of showbiz thing, and they all go very precocious and close to their heads, you know, because it does if you're a little kid.
But, I mean, you deliberately chosen to keep them at ordinary schools as well.
Yeah.
I mean, schools like the ones that you were at.
Yeah.
Why?
I think it's just as good as any other school, and if they go to a sort of posh school, then they're privileged. And they're privileged enough, I suppose, as it is. So we're just trying to keep them normal, you know, just like any other kids. Why shouldn't they go to the same school as everyone else goes to?
And when they're 16, you're going to cut them off without a penny and they're going to go on unemployment.
Funny thing is, actually, they get that kind of mentality themselves. They don't like really taking it off you. They want to do it themselves. That's what's happening, you know. They don't really like to sort of take it too much. They want to go and do it themselves.
Come on, John.
For many of Paul's family, the Wings concert earlier that evening had been a public demonstration that things were still the same. There Paul was still the scouse lad of the early years. And as if to prove the point, Paul had included 4 Beatles songs in his repertoire. For a moment, it was as if time had stood still.
My trouble seems so far away. Now it looks as though they're here to stay. Oh, I believe in yesterday. Suddenly shadow hanging over me. A yesterday came suddenly. Why she had to go, I don't know. She wouldn't say. Something wrong now, I long for yesterday. Yesterday, love was such an easy game to play.
Carry on with the song, which is off the top. The album's called Every Night. Every night I just want to go out, get out of my... Every day I don't want to get up, get out of my bed. Every night I want to play out, and every day I want to do. But tonight I just want to stay and be with you. And be with you. just wanna stay.
Anyway, would you like to hear a tune which is, how are your bums doing anyway? Anyone got sore bums by now? All right, well, I'll tell you what, all stand up. Come on, all stand up. Go on, come on, don't be shy, all stand up. Give your bums a quick rub. Go on, give them a quick rub. Ooh, wow, ooh, that feels better, doesn't it? That's all right. Well, this one's called Coming Up.
Flower!